Namaste. I'm Nagarathna Vinayak Joshi, Harikatha artist, Hubli. Last week, I have narrated a Subhashita in front of you all, which was the first Subhashita in this series. And today, I'm presenting my second Subhashita. Subhashitas are the wise saying, as I have already told you last week, they are very much thought-provoking and intellectually meaning. Ludwig Sternberg, LLD, professor of Dharma Shastra, College de France, Paris, has said, Sanskrit literature has reached its apogee in its didactic poetry with thousands of moral maxims, ethical teachings and wise sayings. These floating expressions of sound judgments preserved in metrical form of mines of practical good sense and evidence of wisdom of Hindus, which elevated them to a high position among the nations of the globe. Sternberg says, Subhashitas are wise sayings, moral maxims, didactic poetry, ethical teachings, which are the floating expressions of sound judgments sung in metrical form by the cuckoo birds of India, and which prove the wisdom of people of India, elevating them to the highest peak among all nations. Recently, the World Environment Day has been celebrated, and afforestation is the main part of environmental protections. So today's Subhashita, which I am going to recite, tells how Indians used to love Mother Nature like anything. Due to urbanization, the trees are being cut and the forest is being burned. And natural calamities are supposed to happen. Misuse of natural resources definitely will lead to disastrous happenings. So, our ancestors had tender feelings, affection, attachment towards plants. They did love all the incredible living beings and thought them as their integral part of life. Today's Subhashita, which I am going to recite, has been chosen from the greatest drama of Kalidasa, Abhijnana Shakuntala. Mahakavi Kalidasa is a great poet. There is a shloka which better explains how talented Kalidasa was. Pura Kavinam Ganana Prasange Kanishtika Tishtita Kalidasa. Once, all those scholars many years ago wanted to count poets on the basis of their greatness in ascending God. They started it from Kalidasa. The counting measure was to fold the fingers. So from the little fingers, as we usually count, 1, 2, 3, 4, they started counting. They told Kalidasa. And after that, they wanted to close the ring finger, fold the ring finger, on behalf of another poet, who could have been more talented than Kalidasa, or equivalent to Kalidasa. But the ring finger is at lingering and the process is still on, and they could never find any other poet more talented than Kalidasa in the history of Indian literature, Sanskrit literature. There are many great poets indeed in Indian literature, but as Kalidasa dealt with the nature in his poems, nobody else would have dealt. So, this shows the majesty of the poet Kalidasa, and his name stands upright and unequivocal. The great masterpiece of Kalidasa, the drama Abhijnana Shakuntala, has been praised by literary critics from all over the world. Kalidasa has been successful in touching the hearts of millions through his great works as he interacted with nature. His characters did love the nature like anything. So probably the Kalidasa had been able to touch the hearts of people. In this drama, Abhijnana Shakuntala, they say, Kavyeshu Natakam Ramyam, Tatra Ramya Shakuntala, Tatra Apichi Chaturthoka, Tatra Shloka Chaturthayam. Drama is the delightful part of literature, is the most delightful part of literature. And especially Abhijnana Shakuntalam is the greatest one among them. And in that Abhijnana Shakuntalam, the fourth scene is the greatest. And in that fourth scene, four shlokas are fantabulous, are excellent. So among those four shlokas, I have chosen the second one, which is the 18th shloka of the fourth chapter. I would like to recite the shloka first and then narrate the meaning. Patum na prathamam vyavasyati jalam yushmasvapiteshuya nadatti priyamandana pibhavatam stekena ya pallavam adhiva kusuma prasuti samaye yasya bhavatyutsavala seyam yati shakuntala patigrugam sarvairanujnyata. Shakuntala is the daughter of Menaka, a celestial nymph and sage Vishwamitra. She was abandoned soon after her birth near Kanvashrama, near the hermitage of sage Kanva. Sage Kanva looked after her and brought her up with utmost care and parental love. He was a person into penance. These tapasvis are supposed to be away from attachments. They are supposed to have the qualities such as discrimination, renunciation, keenness of intellect, viveka, vairagya, and vichakshana. And they should consider these tender feelings, affection, and attachments as burning fires. Shakuntala gets married to King Dushyanta when he had come for hunting. And the sage Kanva will not be there at that moment in the ashram. And when he returns back, he came to know by supreme powers that she has married the most eligible emperor of that time, Dushyanta. And he knew that his supreme powers has also told him that she is going to give birth to a son whose name is Bharata and our country would be named after him. So Kanva is very happy and returned back and he makes all arrangements to send Shakuntala to her husband's home. So at that moment, he tells the trees, plants, creepers surrounding the hermitage that Shakuntala is leaving. Because Shakuntala has watered those plants. She had lived her life in them. She interacted with them. She considered them as integral part of her life. So, Kanva knew all those things. Unable to bear the separation of his daughter, Kanva asks those trees, creepers and plants to permit Shakuntala to go to her husband's home. The way he asks in this shloka is just amazing and soul-throbbing. Patum na pratamam vyavasyati jalam yushmasvapi deshaya. My dear plants, creepers, trees surrounding our hermitage, our Shakuntala is living. How she was? That Shakuntala who did never slake her thirst before watering you all, who did never pluck your flowers, leaves, and twigs and birds for getting dressed up, though she was keen on getting dressed up. Every woman or every girl would be keen on getting dressed up. Even Shakuntala was so. They don't get ornaments of gold, diamond, silver, etc. They used to get dressed up using the twigs, the flowers, the fruits, the leaves of the plants available over there. So even Shakuntala was getting dressed up with the same. But Sage Kanva says, Nadatte priya mandana bhavatam snehena yapallam. Though she was keen on getting dressed up, she was very beautiful as her mother Menaka. And she was very meek, humble, good, like her father Kanva. So, though she was keen on getting dressed up, they did never pluck flowers of you, leaves of you, twigs of you, as she might have thought that she would harm you by that process. The love she did possess about you all did make her not to touch you, though she wanted to get dressed. And then, Adiva Kusuma Prasuti Samaye, Yasya Bhavati Utsava, in your nourishment, and when you sprouted, and when you did blossom, when your fruits were ripened, she enjoyed the moments. She was so enthusiastic. She felt as if she gave birth to a child. So this enthusiasm she experienced is unimaginable. That Shakuntala who watered you up, though she was thirsty and did never slake her thirst first, that Shakuntala, though interested in getting dressed up, did never pluck your flowers or twigs for decoration purpose as ornaments. And that Shakuntala, who was very much enthusiastic and the most happiest person in the world when you did blossom, that Shakuntala is living to her husband's home. Please, all of you, interact with her. Please permit her. Please bless her so that she can lead a very happy life in her husband's home. So touching these lines, this shows how great Kalidasa is. The poet, through his female lead Shakuntala, explains how our ancient people thought flora or greenery as a part of their life. They used to love nature. So, on the eve of World Environment Day, I thought, why don't I explain this shloka, this Subhashita? It can be considered as Subhashita, as it gives a moral to the society that we should love Mother Nature. When we love Mother Nature and she interacts definitely with us, and our feelings will be juxtaposed so that we both live together, one in another. In Bhagavata Dashama Skanda, Lord Shri Krishna tells Gopalakas how important trees are and how useful and helpful they are to society. Pashyataitan Mahabhagan Parartaikanta Jeevitan. Look at these trees. They really spend all their time for benevolent deeds. They bear brunt of wind, rain, heat. They protect all of us from these difficulties of nature. And Krishna tells what and all these trees give us. Patra pushpa palachaya mula valkala darubhi ganda niryasa basmasti tokmai kaman mitanvati. What and all they give? Flowers, leaves, fruits, shade, roots, heat, bark, wood, dew, ashes, pulp, and tender shoots. All these are being given by trees to us. Still, we cut them. Aho yesham varam janma sarva prani upajivanam. They provide sustenance to humans and They live for us. They live for others. They won't live for themselves. But we humans are very greedy. We live for ourselves. And a great poet, the poet Suresh Chandra, says in Hindi that I would have been a tree. So nice it would have been. What and all I would have done if I was a tree. देता सबको शीतल छाया कोई लगता नहीं पराया प्यार लुटाता सब पर ही मैं पक्षी हो या हो चौपाया लेता मैं सबका ही पक्ष अगर कहीं मैं होता वृक्ष सुंदर सुंदर फूल खिलाता खुशबू से जग को महकाता सबको अपने फल दे देता मैं तो इनसे एक न खाता पर सेवा में होता दक्ष अगर कहीं मैं होता वृक्ष मैं दूषित वायु को पीता शुद्ध हवा दे जीवन जीता फटे हुए भूखे आंचल को जड़ धागों से रहता सीता सुख पाता सच्चा प्रत्यक्ष अगर कहीं में होता वृक्ष सर्दी गर्मी वर्षा सहता पर अपना दुख कभी न कहता एक जगह पर खड़ा हुआ मैं त्याग तपस्या मेरत रहता संतों में होता समकक्ष अगर कहीं में होता वृक्ष I would have been a tree means a tree is equal to a saint because saints don't live for themselves, they live for others, and even trees live for others. Here, Margaret Cavendish writes a poem, very nice poem, a dialogue between an oak and the man cutting into. An oak tree asks a man who had come to cut him down, why cut you off my boughs which largely bent? And from the scorching sun do you defend, which did refresh your fainting limbs from sweat, and kept you free from thundering rains and wet, when on my bark you weary head you would lay, where quiet sleep did take all cares away, the whisk my leaves a gentle noise did I make, and blew cold winds that you fresh air make it. Besides, I did invite the birds to sing, that their sweet voice might you some pleasure bring. I called the birds to me, I told them to sing, you were sleeping beneath me, and I did blow fresh air on you, so that you could sleep happily, but still you want to cut me. The tree says, in winter time my shoulder broad did hold of blustering storms, that wounded with sharp cold, and on my head the flakes of snow did fall. Whilst you under my boughs sat free from all, and will you thus require my love? Goodwill to take away my life and body kill for all the care and service I have possessed, I have passed. Must I be cut and laid on fire at last? I did endure blustering storms and snowfalls and the cold winds, but you were sleeping beneath me. I protected you from all these things. I suffered, but I did never let you suffer because I respected that you sleep beneath me and you should get all comforts. I stood for you, but what you are doing? At last, you are going to cut me. For all these things which I have done, all this care, all this service I have passed, must I be cut and laid on fire at last? What are you going to do for me? You are going to cut me and lay me on fire and burn me? Is this right? So at last, I would like to say and conclude, let us protect our environment. Let us protect our mother nature. Let us protect these trees which help us like anything, though they endure a lot many things in their lives. They live for others, and let us learn this skill from them, and let us live for others. Thank you very much. Today I am presenting this Subhashita for you all, and next week I'll be coming with another Subhashita. Till then, Namaste.